So, as 2019 draws to a close, the decade goes with it, and I thought it would be time to take a look through the last 10 years in terms of what good robots there was. So I've taken the effort. I'm gonna say effort. I mean, look at this. Took a lot of doing on my part to make this list. I've broken down each year of the 2010s into one particular robot that was good that came out in that year. Might not be the very best, but they're the ones that I like the most, and honestly, yeah, it did feel particularly difficult. Some years more than others. I mean, like 2014, 2012, not a lot to choose from in the way of stuff that's actually quality, this far down the line from it. But then at the same time, stuff like 2010, that was a year full of loads of legendarily good stuff that we all look back on now as being really good, and it was definitely one of the best years for Transformers toys, just in general, I think. So while the decade started off strong and then had some pretty bumpy bits around the middle, I feel like it's ended pretty strong too. When I look at the things that I've picked out for the last few years here, it's been properly difficult because there's been such a wealth of really top quality stuff, and I don't think we've all really quite realise that. Don't know whether that's just because the past few years I've had more money because of working and stuff, and I've bought more high-end stuff. But it generally does feel like, going back to like 2016, 2017, there has been just too much on offer to really decisively say that's the best stuff, because it's just too much. So yeah, picking the stuff for those years was tough. But here we go. I'm about to justify to you my choices, my picks for the top 10 of the 10s. Starting off then with 2010, it's Revenge of the Fallen of Lockdown. You might have been expecting like a Generations figure, I don't know, like Drift or like the War for Cybertron Optimus. Loads of top tier stuff. I mean, like half the Decepticons, Terradive, loads of stuff off the top of my head I can come to. But one thing stood out for me, and that's this. One particular, I suppose, memory of being able to just walk into my local Tesco supermarket and to pick up just such a stunning figure just off a supermarket shelf. And it just feels like, yeah, it has been a decade since I've been able to do that. To think that this was just sat there amongst all the regular mainline stuff for $12.99, mate, like it's something else. It may not be, an astoundingly perfect figure by today's standards. Some of the articulation's a bit weird, like, why do his legs do that? Why have they ever done that? His knees don't really do what knees should, and the arms are a bit weird, and like the hook hand doesn't bend far enough, and blah blah blah. But he's got a neck, mate. He's got an articulated neck. He's got like three joints in there, and light piping, and such exquisite detail and character. And this is something special, and it's definitely a kind of pedigree of stuff that, like we get today as, your high-end kind of stuff. And this was just mainline movie everywhere. What a time to be alive. Rolling in on a similar kind of wavelength of energy to Lockdown, 2011's pick is Reel the Shield Lugnut. Whoops, I picked two realistically realized animated guys in a row. I only have one, like the three like Legends ones they did. I've got virtually no animated figures anymore. Sold by Blitzwing. I've only got Waspinator and a handful of little tiny Autobots. Animated is something that just still doesn't really mean very much to me. The show was good and there's loads of great stuff that's come from it. But I don't need animated toys in my collection. But Lugnut and Lockdown, this is something else. Again, this is the kind of thing that feels like, how did we get this kind of level of quality in a main line? It's astounding. And again, for me, it's got a nice sort of memory of getting it attached to it. This was my Easter present in 2011. Walked into a relatively local shop that now is shut, and I've walked around the kind of half-gutted corpse of, and I just went in there and found Lugnut there, and I was like, oh my days, mate, these are out now. I can just pick up Lugnut and buy him, and don't have to order him off somewhere or whatever. Yeah, that was really good. And of course, if you know this figure, it's quite astoundingly nice, full of all the sort of gimmicky stuff with the punching and the fingies and the mouth, and the light piping doesn't quite work, and all the detail and stuff and the massive wingspan of his alt mode. There's so much to like here, and once again, it feels like there's so much going on, so much that was just put into this one figure that we don't get anymore. It just really feels like, yeah, this is something worth noting down in the annals of Transformers history. And let's face it, when like Theo said in his review, you know, there never needs to be a better Lugnut toy done. That still holds true. Like, you can't do better than this. So, you know, the decade started off really, really strong with all of the Revenge of the Fallen kind of spillover hype and money and Hunt for the Decepticons and Power Core Combiners and Generations and Reveal the Shield. And then Dark of the Moon was, it was okay, it was good. Felt like a bit of a step down at the time, but I think it still holds up good. But what came after? Well, if you know, you know. 2012 has to be the absolute nadir of recent Transformers efforts. Everything was cheap, everything was flimsy and small and lacked paint. And Fall of Cybertron Bruticus is an abomination, let's face it. At the time, I bought all the bits and I thought, oh, this is kind of fun and cool. Look at it now. Oh God, everything, nearly everything from 2012 sucks. It's terrible. Prime, it kind of gets away here and there with some interesting stuff, especially some of the original stuff like Rumble and Cup. But so much of that is just like, no, it's just forget about it. It's not good. It's not good. Fall of Cybertron Optimus, kind of decent, but I'm not picking him. My one figure for 2012 is it's Prime Hotshot. Prime, in general, overall, is a thing that I'm happy to kind of forget now, and I feel like I keep looking at my Prime figures and thinking, if I'm going to sell anything else, because I have been selling quite a few bits over the last year, they're the next on the chopping block, because I just don't really care about them. They're not really anything that special. The designs are kind of just a little bit dated now, and they represent this kind of weirdly bland and morose kind of blend of the movie aesthetic and style and realism with animated chops. And I don't know. I don't know how I feel about Prime anymore. But Hotshot, definitely the standout figure from that line. Because, mate, when I got this, it's just, yes, love it, love it, love it. Metallic blue. You know, the automorph stuff he does, the guns on his arms, the posability, the character, the goggles, the light piping, the flames, gorgeous alt mode, wonderful transformation. It's just like the perfect deluxe figure. And yes, he's a little bit simple compared to, you know, what we would have had for a couple of the years before, you know, especially if you compare like this and Lockdown and realize they're both the same price point and they're only 2 years apart. Like, that just illustrates what happened in 2012, really, doesn't it? How things went downhill. But it didn't drop too far because this is still very nice and it's still something that does mean a lot to me. I mean, yes, I've always liked Hotshot the best, but when I got this figure, it kind of cemented it because it felt like here is a Hotshot that conforms to other sensibilities and aesthetic preferences I have that come from other things which aren't hot shots. You know, it's like having a hot shot that's metallic blue like this. It's like, oh mate, this was good. It still is good. But sadly, you know, it's not brilliant, is it, these days? So 2013 kind of carried on the kind of vaguely bad feel. It did step things up a bit, didn't it? You know, that like third wave of Fall of Cybertron stuff, at least they had a bit more paint, a bit more character. Bigger guns, Beast Hunters had bigger guns, that weird swirly plastic that we never saw again, which I kind of liked actually. But you've just seen it flash up at the bottom of the screen. You know what's coming. 2013, there's only one figure that you can possibly mention or talk about. It's Generation Springer. Like, nothing else comes close, nothing else is remotely worth looking at or talking about. It's this or nothing. I still kind of like the Blitzwing in ways. I've sold like Orion packs. Again, it feels like that's a selection of stuff from that year that's kind of like, do I still need it anymore? Do I still care about it anymore? I don't know. I got Siege Springer this year. He's very good. Very, very good. Is he better than this one? It's very hard to say. It does feel more polished and streamlined and just it's a tighter thing and it's It's just nice and modern and shiny and solid. But this is still very good. This is still very much worth a spot in anyone's collection. Who knows when the next time we're going to get such sort of comic accurate looks is going to be, now that the comics just aren't really that same kind of thing. While we're talking about, you know, plastic for the 2010s, this sort of year represents what was also a height in terms of like Matumty and Wreckers and all that kind of thing in print, in the graphic medium. And it feels like we're still riding that wave in terms of that in a lot of ways. But at the same time, it's like now the new comic series, I feel like I can kind of leave it. It's a bit sad to say that. But yeah, here we go. Springer represents, you know, what was, while the toys were feeling a bit shaky, what was a really nice kind of strong heart to the fandom overall in terms of all the offerings of other media. And is just, you know, what felt like a bit of a last hurrah to the old design team, pushing out something that was just stellar and mind-blowing before they kind of went a little bit mad and some shrunky stuff, some shaky stuff, before we get to what I would say is a little bit of a renaissance with 2014. Now, technically, I suppose what I'm about to show you, you could say is a 2015 offering. I got it sort of far enough away from the beginning of 2015, it counts to me as a 2014 figure. This was certainly a bit of a turning point, certainly a bit of a, what felt like a really big step up. It's Combinables Optimus. I love it. I still love this thing so much. I honestly haven't been as excited about finding a new figure in a shop since, I think, since I found this in Smize in like November 2014. That was a moment I was really taken aback. I mean, when this thing was first revealed, when Combinables in general was first revealed, well, before we knew they were Combiners and it was just Generations and they were trying to keep it secret, and they showed this off, I was like, that's terrible. It's ugly, it's horrible, I hate it. What's going on with those proportions? And then someone got one in like China or wherever and combined it and opened up that chest and showed me the Energon homage that is hidden within it, and I was like, I need it. I don't care. I don't care what it looks like, what it does, how it feels, how much it costs. I need it right now. And then I went in Smize and found it. Like, what? Sorry? When does that happen? When has that happened since? You know, that whole moment, that whole just kind of instant gratification, that instant, I've got the figure I really want in my hands, all my days feeling, you know, months ahead of expecting it to be out, coats this in such a sheen, more than, you know, the actual sheen it has of all its lovely shiny parts. It just makes it radiant in mine eyes, and I still love it. You know, you might think this was a real big like misstep, like what were they doing, what's going on with half of this thing? Why does he look like that? Why does a truck mode look like that? Why does a combined mode look like that? I don't care. Don't care. I love it. I love everything about this. Because it was a return to, like, inbuilt gimmickry, combination, all that kind of super mode stuff. It's big! You know, up to the top of his head, it's the same height as the top of the head of Armada Megatron. You know, discount the antlers and all the extra tank tread guff that makes him even taller. To the top of his head, he's the same height as that figure. And like, mate, it's a Voyager, you know? He's big, he's solid, he's chunky, ratcheting all over the place. And just what felt like a real return to finally solid build quality. It's built like a solid as a rock, gorgeous feel, just closest thing to like Unicron Trilogy back again. And yeah, that's my pick for 2014. You know, you can have your evasion mode Optimuses and all your various other Thrilling 30 stuff that was very good. The very sort of end of that line was great stuff, wasn't it? Loads of colour, loads of variety. It was great, you know. But let's face it, Age of Extinction, very, very shaky. All that beginning of, you know, the kind of cheapy line of, you know, one step changes for the first time and kind of cutting everything in half and saying, these are for the kiddies, these are for the collectors. That kind of shaky period, but Combinables kind of just brought it home. It brought home so much that was so good, and this is what I will use to represent that. because it was the beginning of that, and I don't know, I just feel like it this epitomizes everything I liked about that, and everything that kind of came in the next couple of years in terms of just improvement in quality in the main lines. So for 2015, which, in my mind still exists as the year of Combiner Wars and, RID, but let's face it, the first year of RID, there's nothing there that's worth talking about. It was bad. It was just not very good. What I'm going to talk about instead is a masterpiece, boy. G2 Bumblebee, oh, he's so lovely. Like, today, he's my favourite masterpiece figure, because he's just little and he's just this kind of compact, shiny bauble of loveliness. Yes, okay, he's missing a couple of joints you might expect in a masterpiece figure. His wrists don't move, oh no. But look at him, he's so shiny and gorgeous, and all of the engineering is so lovely, and it just makes him feel like the best deluxe figure ever. And now we're going to be getting Earthrise Cliffjumper in the new year. That looks like you've just taken this whole figure and offered it to me for half the price at a deluxe price point. And it's like, mate, that looks great. If I was really going to push that comparison, I would say Earthrise Cliffjumper might as well be Masterpiece Cliffjumper to me, because it looks like it's this thing, it's roughly the same size, but he's got wrists now, and he's got his big bazooka, and he's got skis, and it's like, what else do you need for a Cliffjumper, But at the same time, it's a bit like, why is this still the only mini bot they've done? Where is my actual Masterpiece Cliffjumper? Where's Beachcomber and Warpath and where's all the little blokes, They nailed it so well with a little diddy masterpiece with Bumblebee here, and then they've made it even better by making him all gold and shiny and giving him a jetpack and the faceplate face, and I love it. I don't particularly, like G1 Bumblebee all that much. Yes, he's kind of an icon now, since the film and all that, and he's come back into his own with the Volkswagen-y feel. But this, you just take that, just nice roundy robot, make him super poseable, make him shiny, and it's the best. Definitely something that has been now for years very difficult for me to put down, because it's just so much fun. Kicking it in at 2016, we're keeping it high end, I'm afraid. I didn't really want to go this route because 2016, like 2015 being a year of Combiner Wars in my mind, 2016 is Titans Return, and we all know that was flipping. I'm trying to just sort of blithely blurt out an analogy here for how good it was, and it was so good I can't think of one. It was amazing, wasn't it? Titans Return 4. Hey, co, four, I say. But I'm afraid nothing in this list is Titans Return. It didn't get a look in. Trigger Happy was certainly a contender. There were various things that were contenders, but ultimately I felt like, are they really definitive of the line as a whole, of the year as a whole? I don't know. Picking one particular Titans Return figure, I couldn't do it because there's so much that was so good. Was there one that was standing out head and shoulders above the rest? I don't think so. So it just gets an honourable mention as being like the best flipping line we've had in ages and ages and ages. But the figure I'm going to be talking about for 2016 is Masterpiece Hot Rod. Yeah, boy, I mean, I didn't really think that I could enjoy proper masterpiece figures like this, because up to this point, all the masterpieces I'd got, just funny repaint ones, G2, Diaclone, off the wall, obscure weirdos that aren't the characters the mold was made to represent. And then I got Hot Rod, and it was like, oh man, this is so nice. This was a TF Nation purchase from the first TF Nation. It was expensive, this represented the first kind of step up in terms of prices of masterpieces, which of course now you can look at and go, I was making a face at spending 60 quid when Sunstreaker costs 90. Sweet summer child, what innocent days we lived in. Yeah, Hot Rod, it was a bit of a gamble at the time. I was like, do I really want to spend 60 quid? 60 quid on him? No! And then I opened him up, sat in the bar at TF Nation, and I was like, oh, this is worth 60 quid. This is sublime, it's gorgeous, it's one of the most, for me, because the movie was a very big part of what G1 was to me. It's like Hot Rod Galvatron and then all the blokes in the Dreamwave guidebooks. That's G1 to me. So to have a Hot Rod that looks so much like he did in the film with the kind of flip down visor for extra coolness, and he's got the guns and he's got the chrome and he's got the frames, and he just, again, super poseable. A little bit messy around the back, but I can live with it because it's clever the way it all folds up and compresses and clips in. Feels good, feels nice, the alt mode, gorgeous. He's got the fishing rod and the saw blade that are cool and I've used all of once, but they're nice little touches, aren't they? And his Hot Rod being vaguely more, you know, sort of pink than red. It's a good look. It's a photogenic look. I have taken so many gorgeous photos of this thing. If I was going to chuck you a portfolio of all my robot photos I've ever taken, there'd be a good few that were just this figure, because it's so good to look at and it just plays with the light so well and it's so characterful and it's just like, you know, put the Matrix in his hand. There's so much you can do with this figure. There's so much that this figure encapsulates in terms of the character from the film that was, you know, that protagonist, the robot Luke Skywalker that he is, that represents all that enthusiasm and, I don't know, just fun and energy and everything's going to be cool if you just go for it kind of feeling. It's great, isn't it? So, 2017, eh? Let's forget about the last night. Doesn't even get a look in. Titans Return. You know, even like that back end of Titans Return. It's like you can say 2016 was the year of that line. 2017 was also the year of that line because, like, Overlord, Blitzwing, mate. Yeah, even more good stuff from that. And other generation stuff like Legends from Takara and this offering from Takara. Yes, Unite Warriors. Baldigus. Oh, mate, Ruination. I love you. I mean, I could have picked another Masterpiece figure. Masterpiece Optimus Primal. He was from this year. He was very good. The Toy Colors one, mate, yeah, really good. This was another year that was like, how do I pick this stuff? Because there was Masterpiece Movie Optimus as well, that's like still kind of feels like the best thing I own. But no, it had to be Ruination. Sorry if I'm offending your pedant sensibilities by really offering you five figures here, but come on, you can only buy them together in this one set as a box. Can't buy them separately, come on, it's one toy. It's a big combiner. It's gorgeous. It's just so good. There needed to be a combiner in this list. It's been loads of these bloody things, ain't there? You know, massive, slightly wobbly gestalts, you know, out the wazoo. And Ruination is the best one. Because she's Ruination. But also because this is just sublime. Yeah, it's not the deco that I personally would have wanted. But now I like it. It's so good. Look at all the gold. Look at all the gold. It looks like a Christmas decoration. Flipping Mova like this. Perfect, perfect new poseable big Mova and roll bar. Like, yes, he hasn't got the sandy bits I would just kill for. But it's a big, lush, high-end, perfectly, really, let's face it, perfectly realised set of those RID Commando blokes that are just some of my favourites, and or at least, you know, two of my all-time favourites. And you've got the proper punchy clenched fists and the big feet that move properly and actually make him stand up, and doesn't get better than that. So moving into 2018 and getting to the more sort of recent offerings, there's a difficulty there in kind of detaching and distancing myself from the stuff, because it's like it's still so fresh in your mind because it was only last year, and it's like, oh, do I pick something from Siege? Because technically that came out in, you know, December or November, whatever it was. But at the same time, it's like, no, that doesn't feel like it was around for enough of 2018. Siege is for 2019. Let's leave that, put that to one side. What does it leave you with in 2018? Power of the Primes wasn't really that good, was it? Let's face it. And Studio Series, that was cool. That gave you a lot of really cool things. But can I pick one figure from that encapsulates that? Maybe Starscream. Blackout was nice, but at the same time, isn't really that great. I don't know. Ultimately, I just looked at everything and I was like, my gaze keeps falling upon this one thing. And while Power of the Primes isn't really worthy of kind of taking a spot in this list because after Titans Return being so good, after Combiner Wars making such a solid foundation for generations going forwards, Power of the Primes are just like, oh, that's the last bit. Don't want to use a Star Wars analogy because I did like the film, but let's say that's that. It's the Rise of Skywalker of the Prime Wars trilogy, isn't it? It was all over the place. It was a bit of a mess. It was a bit rushed. It was a bit. Here's a bit of this bit. Here's a bit of that bit. You know, using very much of the first part of the trilogy, going back to that, and kind of ignoring all the really good stuff you set up in the second bit. But all the same, it did give you something really damn cool, didn't it? And it's Optimal Optimus. Oh, mate, he's big, he's chunky, he's poseable. It's not G1. It's a Beast Wars guy. It's a guy I remember from, like, the telly cartoon. Even though, actually, when I think about it, the episodes with him in weren't broadcast here, so I think I only remember it from getting them on a DVD in like 2002. I don't know. Time, memory, conflation of ideas, Mandela effects. All that aside, it's the Optimus Primal from my childhood. It's the thing I remember. It's a new toy. It's an update of a thing I remember seeing on shelves. And I guess I kind of never actually really wanted it at the time. But having a figure of that feels great, you know? So it doesn't do all the things that the old one did. And it's not covered in chrome and lights up and has an angry, snarling gorilla face and makes a weird truck with fists poking out the front. It still captures for me everything that I would want in a figure of this bloke that I remember from the cartoon. And isn't that enough? Isn't that what loads and loads of people are riding on with generations in terms of the G1 stuff? But it's for me. It's for me. It's something for people of my age who grew up and were little tykes when this bloke was stomping around on the screen going, "There he is, my little guy." You might not like the fact that all this hangs off his back, basically a whole other robot. It doesn't bother me at all because the rest of it is so good. It's such a good action figure. Even if the alt modes are a bit weird and a bit like, really? You think that's finished? It's so good. He's got the Matrix in there. You can stick the guns poking out of his chest. He's got massive mitts, opening hands. Every single joint feels sublime, and every motion is this huge chunk of beef moving. And he's got massive feet that will go all over the place. I mean, he always stands up, and it's just such a satisfying robot. So while the line he came from maybe isn't really worth taking a spot in the top 10 of the decade, this one figure kind of is. Like, you know, at least Power of the Primes gave us this. At least that fan vote went the correct way and gave us something that is just great, great, proper bow. Because as we all know, for the last year of the decade, 2019 dived headfirst into Nout But G1. Unless you want to count some of the interesting stuff that Cyberverse has thrown us, which I have enjoyed, and I'm still looking forward to getting hold of some of that. But let's face it, 2019 is Siege, isn't it? It's Siege. What else have we had? Cyberverse Studio Series, that kind of last end of the Bumblebee stuff. Well, 2 out of 3 is the kiddie stuff that you can't really say is objectively good. It certainly doesn't trump anything else. While I've been enjoying it and I like it and it's fun and it's colourful and it's there's so much of a variety, especially with Cyberverse, you know, pulling stuff out like what we're gonna get a Quintess on in Cyberverse. Siege is unbeatable because it has represented the greatest step up in quality that we've had since, I don't know, like, can you compare the kind of quantum leap between like the Prime figures and like T-30 Springer? And you compare the leap between Thrilling 30 and Combiner Wars to this? I don't know, can you? Because Siege, Starscream especially, is like far and away. It's like, oh wow, okay, now we feel like we're living in the future. Now it feels like we're getting stuff that's ahead of its time, or actually rather, no, not ahead of its time, but perfectly of its time. This is where we should be going into 2020. This is where we should be in the second, third, 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 decade of the 21st century, this detail just oozing out of virtually every pore. It's like he has pores. There's so much going on in the sculpt for this. You might not like it. I love it. Especially since I realised that it's basically like all of that overwrought Star Wars spaceship detail. And it's like, oh, actually, mate, sticking that on a Transformer. Yes, please. So, Starscream. You may have thought, oh, Optimus is a good pick for the best Siege figure. You know, the Galaxy Upgrade Optimus is nice because it's something that, again, is a homage that I appreciate more and all that. But really, do any of them hold a candle to the step up in terms of engineering and design that the Seacom mold represents? No, they don't. His arms do that. He's got butterfly joints and shoulders. His wrists curl down. He does that so you can have him properly like point the null rays like that. His legs will go all over the place. You know, these hips need to be on everything now. Don't give me any of that skirt folds out of the way barely and then the leg doesn't really go very much higher than that nonsense. No, leave that in the past. That is old. That is outdated. That is crap. You might have had that on loads of masterpieces. I'm looking at Hot Rod. He does that, the stupid skirt thing. No, it's bad. When was that ever a good design? Hips need to do this. The whole bit needs to move like that. And he can kick all the way up there and his knees bend and then you poke the bit in the back of his calf and they bend even further. What? And he's got these stupid hoof feet. I'm not sure if I really like his feet because I like the kind of, I suppose, the inverse of that shape, the scoopy G1 feet. Anyway, they do that, don't they? They move up and down and they tilt and they point and he's got a waist. He's a Seacom with a waist. Like, there's very nearly nothing that this figure can't do. You know, even the wings will get out of the way and pose and emote and flap around in the wind like a cape. And he's got light piping back. There's so much that this offers that is exactly what we need to be having back as a standard. The kind of thing that, really, I'm looking back at this little array of things I've chosen here, and it's like, closest thing I can think of is, it's like going back to Lugnut. It's going back to that kind of 2011 Reveal the Shield era, where light piping is a standard, where super articulation is a standard, where mind-blowing detail is a standard. You know, oh, it just feels so right. And while you may not be a fan of the alt mode, I am, because, you know, it reminds me of that Battlestar Galactica spaceship, or an X-Wing or whatever. You know, it's just this perfect meld of, like, retro, which, you know, you might think isn't quite right, but actually really works. I think one of the things I've really enjoyed about the Siege alt modes is this retro future feel they have. You know, they feel like they're products of the 80s or the late 70s, you know? Starscream drips with, like, Empire Strikes Back design energy. And all the scuffed paint, you know, while he may have a bit too much in this mode, in the alt mode, it actually works because it's put on bits that are already painted another colour, so it actually looks like the paint has rubbed off and it looks all worn and just that, again, that kind of Star Wars level of realism where things look a bit beaten up. Yes, the battle damage paint was a bit overdone on a lot of figures. Didn't need to be there. But with Starscream, at least in his alt mode, and I kind of like all the stuff on like the bits on like the blue bits on his legs, because again that looks like the blue paint has been worn away on some bits. Some of it works really, really well, and I feel like this is the figure that exemplifies everything about Siege, to be perfectly honest. And it's the only Seeker of this body type that I've got. Because for bloody once, it felt like just Starscream was enough. I don't need Thundercracker. Skywarp set with the little Target Master blokes would be fun, but that's because of the little Target Master blokes he comes with, not because of Skywarp. I don't give a monkeys about Red Wing or the Poundland Colours Rainmakers. So there we go. Starscream's enough. For once, just Starscream is enough. Because this alone offers so much to enjoy. It's definitely one thing I haven't put down. I got this in like April, May, whatever. I got it in the first half of the year and it hasn't really left my side since then. It's like, I could go on, you know, critique it about how the chest isn't actually the cockpit, and why don't we get Starscreams anymore where the front just lifts up and makes the nose cone? You know, looking at the Earthrise one, I'm kind of good, thanks. You know, I don't really want a bigger Classics one. I want one that looks a bit more G1, and, you know, while Classics may be a long time ago now, you know, and maybe worth homaging and updating, you know, that figure specifically, that just feels weird. I don't want him to work like that, and it looks like he's a step back because he's got the hips that are a skirty flap, and his arms don't do that, and his feet don't do all this, and it just looks like it's a step backwards. How is it a step backwards? I really want a Voyager F-15, you know, classic-y looking Seeker mould, but I don't want that one. So it's damn bloody good that Siege Starscream is so spectacular. So from 10 to 19, that's the journey through the decade in terms of robots that I picked. We're living in a good time for Transformers, you know. We're certainly on an upward trend, or at least a brief spike, you know. Things are in the kind of rising position with Siege. Be thankful, you know, we're not still stuck in the kind of 2012 cheapo standard. It's good. It's good stuff. Roll on 2020. Roll on the next 10 years of sublime robots. And I don't want to make any, you know, broad sweeping forecasts or predictions, because who the hell knows what's going to happen, you know? Basically, we're running out of G1 stuff to retread in generations, aren't we? So I'm going to be hoping that we retread some of the stuff I would like to see. Where the hell is that Armada Optimus prototype that was at the, like, Wonderfest in February? February they showed that off. Where are you? Where is it? What have you done with it? I need it. I need some news. I need to see a coloured version of it. What have you done with the prototype? Why haven't you brought it out again, Takara? What's going on? Tell me. So maybe we'll be getting some Armada stuff. I'm hoping that's where it's going to go, you know, Armada, Energon, Beast Wars, R.I.D., whatever, please give us something that isn't G1, because of course Earthrise is the most G1 we could possibly ask for, and while I like that, I'm very much looking forward to Wheeljack and Grapple, Hoist, oh yeah boy, yeah boist. what's going to happen after that? Who can say? Who the hell can say? You know, will Cyberverse continue after that? Is it going to get more than 3 seasons? Or is this next thing with Quintessons and going back to Cybertron going to wrap things up there? Who knows? But one thing which I feel, if anything, for the last 18 months, can sort of lend to, I don't know, be runes for me to read for scraying of the future, it's that there's going to be some unpredictable stuff. And that is what I'm here for. I want to be surprised. I want to be seeing more random people turn up in Cyberverse to get cheapo figures that are all over the supermarkets. I want to see some crazy stuff turn up in generations I might not have expected, but wholeheartedly will certainly instantly want to fire money at. But all in all, I think the best thing to ask for with the coming decade is that it represents same kind of journey that the last one has, you know? Because when you put the last 10 years, and that's a long time, worth of robots out like this, and I'm looking at the 10 that I picked, it's such a variety. The next 10 years might be brilliant if it all keeps to Siege standards, but, you know, it won't be special after a while, will it? And sadly, I suppose there's a bit of a trend there that masterpieces are getting way too expensive. You know, I'm basically priced out of that market. What does that leave you with? What does that leave me with as a collector going into 2020? Well, it leaves me very excited for more Cyberverse and Earthrise and all of that wild, wacky, off-the-wall stuff that hopefully I'll find in a shop. Wouldn't it be good if we had a nice Bumblebee sequel? Oh, mate. Yeah. I'm just gonna leave it there. You know, let's see what 2020 and the coming years brings, because in order to really enjoy whatever it's going to be, you've got to let go of those expectations and you've just got to accept what it is, because at the time, you know, that's what we did through the last 10 years. You know, 2012 might have been a bit of a
sticky one, a bit of a, oh no, it's a bit bad situation, but
there was still at least something to enjoy, even at those lowest points of the brand. There's something there. I'd really be surprised if we're ever going to get it dipped down to that level. But I don't know, we're destroying the climate, the ocean's full of plastic, so will we even be able to do this in 10 years' time? Is my hobby destroying the planet? Will there be a climate that I can exist in 10 years' time? Where I live will probably be an island again, I'd imagine. Yeah, the world is burning, but enjoy the robots that we've had while we've been able to live in a world that can give us toy robots. That's a nice note to end on, isn't it? See you soon.